good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, everybody. It's good to see you again this Lord's Day morning as we're gathered here to worship God through the way that's been opened for us by the Lord Jesus. And we worship in spirit and in truth today. Welcome also if you are joining us in terms of our live stream, or indeed later in the week in terms of our recorded media. We trust God will bless you even as you watch along. Just as we begin, before we do our call to worship, just going to share a notice or two with you. We still have a couple of copies of Sam Gordon's book, so if you missed out on a copy, and to be honest, even if you can't afford a copy, come and let me know, we'll see what we can do. But we have a couple of copies, there's no point in us keeping them, we'd rather get them out and get them read. Obviously, our weekly services, while this lockdown continues, will be online and take place via Zoom. So that's our prayer meeting on Tuesday, our Bible study on Thursday. The Bible study is available afterwards on CD as part of an audio, or even as MP3 if you are so inclined. We're going to look at Scripture for the first time as part of our call to worship. And in responding to God's call, we're then going to pray, and then we're going to hear a song sung. And of course, the point of the song, even though we cannot congregationally sing, the song is important because it allows us to begin to tune our hearts to worship. I don't know about you, I still love listening to the radio. I just got a DAB radio for Christmas, just a cheapish one, but it works. And the only thing, it's beautiful, the sound's great, but the only thing I miss is the tuning, that crackle, as you used to tune the old analog radios. Really miss that. It just goes click, and then there's the next station. So, but there you go. You know, you win some, you lose some. But this morning, we're just going to win, because we get to tune our hearts to worship and to respond to God in our own hearts. So, as we sing, as the ladies sing, Fiona and Shirley sing to us, let's take the opportunity to tune our hearts. We can stand, we can close our eyes, we can even mouth the words quietly to ourselves, but it's not a spectator sport. The point is that we individually, as well as corporately, come before the Lord. Turn with me in your Bibles to Psalm 117. Psalms are just in the really centre section of the book, of the Bible. Prayer book of Israel. Psalm 17 is noted because it's the shortest psalm. Unlike two psalms on when we get to Psalm 119, if we use that for our call to worship, we'd have to have a specially lengthened edition of our Sunday worship. But this is the word of the Lord. Praise the Lord, all nations. Extol him, all peoples. For great is his steadfast love toward us, and the faithfulness of the Lord endures forever. Praise the Lord. Amen. There's a quiet reminder in every call to worship that worship is not our idea. We worship God because it's his idea. Psalm 117 is a wonderfully encouraging part of God's word, which means that it's God who is speaking to us as a demonstration of his people. And in speaking to us, he commands us, he invites us, he exhorts us, encourages us to praise him, just as it says there in verse 1. This call is rooted in a firm commitment both to his glory and our good. Okay, his glory and our good. When God's people are gathered in his name, he serves as the host. He has initiated and invited us into fellowship with him. And the response that we see in Psalm, the response in Psalm 117 implies a recognition of who God is, of his worth. It speaks of his steadfast love and his faithfulness. And that's what we want to encounter. That's what I want you to encounter today. That you not only just come to a service, such as that, whatever that means, but that you encounter God as he is, and that you experience his steadfast love and his faithfulness. In the call to worship, we remember that it's God alone who is worthy to have our hearts, our lips, and our lives. And as truth resounds through us, we're reminded of the object of our worship. Worship in the rhythm of our Christian lives begins with God making himself known and is followed by our response. So we're going to pray together and then we're going to hear a song. So let's pray. Almighty and everlasting Father, Lord, you have called us together to worship you once again. You've spoken to us through your word, and we recognize you, Lord, for who you are. We recognize, Lord, that the psalmist's worship is not guesswork. It is informed. It is informed by you speaking and you revealing yourself. Lord, we recognize too that your word betokens your character and nature, and that because this is your word, it's the most powerful force in the universe. For all that is and all that we are upheld solely by its power. Lord, not only has your word created and shaped our reality, but in your mercy you've revealed yourself to us. You've brought us forth to new life in Christ by your word. And you've granted to us your great and precious promises, so that through them we might, by grace, become partakers of the divine nature. Lord, may our response to you this morning be wholehearted. May it be pleasing in your sight. Help us to get a glimpse of your beauty and another taste of your goodness, even as we rejoice in you once again. We ask all this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. 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 As we hear this song, so shall we stand together?
Rage, kingdoms rise and fall. There is still one King reigning over all. So I will not fear, for this truth remains that my God is the Ancient of Days. Not above. Of days, none above. of days. For my God is the Ancient of Days.
Every week as we come to worship together, we have the opportunity to admit to ourselves and, in a sense, to each other before God, that we do not always live as we are called. As we approach the preaching of the word, when we look to God to speak to us afresh, we come to a place where we want to anticipate that. We want to lean in to the experience of hearing God's word. And in order to do that, one of the ways we're going to do that is Fiona's going to sing a song to us, which talks about God speaking to us. And then as we hear that, we're going to just have a prayer of confession and readiness to hear God's word as we come to open our Bibles together.
Speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word. Take your truth, plant it deep in us, shape and fashion us in your likeness, that the light of Christ might be seen today in our acts of love and our deeds of faith. Speak, O Lord, and fulfill in us all your purposes for your glory. Teach us, Lord, full obedience, holy reverence, true humility. Test our thoughts and our attitudes in the radiance of your purity. Cause our faith to rise, cause our eyes to see your majestic love and authority. Words of power that can never fail, let their truth prevail over unbelief. Speak, O Lord, and renew our minds. Help us grasp the heights of your plans for us. Truths unchanged from the dawn of time that will echo down through eternity. And by grace we'll stand on your promises, and by faith we'll walk as you walk with us. Speak, O Lord, till your church is built and the earth is filled with your glory. Your promises, and by faith we'll walk as you walk with us. Speak, O Lord, till your church is built and the earth is filled with your glory.
Let's pray together. If we have confessed our sins, if we have repented of our sin and put our faith in Christ, if we've been born again in God's Spirit, we have a wonderful privilege. That privilege is to stand on the very promises of God. It's not to walk by our own intellect, by our own wisdom, but it's to walk as a follower of Christ. Lord, we want to ready ourselves to hear your word. Lord, as we hear your word, Lord, we want to, as it were, see your glory proclaimed amongst us. Lord, we desire to walk in the light. Lord, even as you are in the light. Lord, so in order to do that, Lord, even as we do personally every day, Lord, we need to recognize and confess our sins and our own waywardness to you. Lord, as a demonstration of your people, we recognize, Lord, that we have at times been faithless and careworn again this week. Lord, our gaze has been diverted from you, and in sinning we've turned in on ourselves. Lord, as we confess our failings before you, Lord, quietly in the depths of our hearts, help us to focus and glory in the one who has been faithful for us, the Lord Jesus. Help us again to rejoice in the forgiveness and pardon that you offer in Jesus Christ alone. Strengthen us, Father, by your Spirit, by that very Spirit who dwells in us, that we may be ruthless in dealing with temptation as we encounter it. Help us, Lord, to hold up the shield of faith, that we might extinguish the fiery darts of the enemy and continue to stand for you in this evil day. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Turn with me, if you have a Bible, to Exodus and chapter 24. If you don't have a Bible, please come and see us afterwards and we'll get you one and you can have one. It's important that you have access to a Bible. We're going to continue our look through the book of Exodus. If you're unfamiliar with our style, we are front-loading our time together with God's Word because we want to do everything else that we do as part of our worship in light of what God says to us. And in terms of our regular diet, if you like, apart from your oatmeal in the morning and your soup at lunchtime, we have a diet, if you like, spiritually, of what we'd like to, or what we hope to be, expository preaching. That is, that we take the Bible seriously. We see it as our only ultimate rule for life and for faith. And we try to preach through it systematically, learning the lessons that God has for us. We approach it as God's word. Not just, if you like, the expression of humans trying to find God, but as God speaking to us. We recognize the 66 books are human. They were written by human authors, but they were, who knows, maybe one of them was called Arthur, I don't know. Human authors, but as directed by God himself. We believe in the inspiration, the infallibility of Scripture. And so it is important to us as we come toward it. So I just want to read again from that chapter that we're in. We're more than halfway through our trawl through the book of Exodus. It won't take us as long as it took to get through Genesis, so that's the good news. But it's taken us a lot longer than it'll take us to get through the book of Jude. So if you're waiting for Jude, stick with us. Okay, this is what the word says. Then he said to Moses, "Come up to the Lord, you and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel, and worship from afar. Moses alone shall come near to the Lord, but the others shall not come up near, and the people shall not come up with him." Moses came and told the people all the words of the Lord and all the rules. And all the people answered with one voice and said, "All the words that the Lord has spoken, we will do." And Moses wrote down all the words of the Lord. He rose early in the morning and built an altar in front at the foot of the mountain and 12 pillars according to the 12 tribes of Israel. And he sent young men of the people of Israel who offered burnt offerings and sacrificed peace offerings of oxen to the Lord. And Moses took half the blood and put it into basins, and half the blood he threw against the altar. Then he took the book of the covenant and read it in the hearing of the people. And they said, "All that the Lord has spoken we will do, and we will be obedient." And Moses took the blood and threw it on the people and said, "Behold, the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with all these words." Then Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel went up, and they saw the God of Israel. There was under his feet, as it were, a pavement of sapphire stone, like the very heaven for clearness. And he did not lay his hand upon the chief men of the people of Israel. They beheld God and ate and drank. The Lord add his blessing to his word. Picture with me, if you will, the people of Israel. Not as here, amassed on the foothills of Sinai, but much later. Picture them installed in the land of Canaan, beyond the days of Joshua, the Judges, Samuel, and King David, in a time of relative prosperity and peace. The land's oft-troubled borders, the nations around them are silent, and the surrounding empires have fallen into decay. It's a time of comfort and ease, the times most of us long for. Everything appears well. Prosperity, peace, and privilege are easy to see. Yet behind the scenes, there was an insidious malady, if you like. There was what commentators and scholars call truth decay. Not tooth decay, truth decay. Lulled by their ease and attracted by the idols of the nations, God's people again fell into false worship. And this, of course, inevitably led to the increase of social injustice and immorality. In that day, almost 800 years before Jesus' birth, God calls a handyman, a jack of all trades, to attend to the hearts of his people. His name is Amos. And Amos writes as part of an indictment and as part of God's speaking judgment on his wayward people. He writes this in chapter 8. "Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord God, when I will send a famine on the land. Not a famine of bread, nor a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. They shall wander from sea to sea and from north to east. They shall run to and fro to seek the word of the Lord, but they shall not find it." I start here. You might think, what has this got to do with Exodus? I start here, I hope, to paint a picture of contrast, to point to where Israel fell. Even as it were, as they stood on the heights of Sinai, glorying in the presence and the power and the purpose of God, there were hard times to come. If you like, they started on the hills of Exodus, hills of Sinai in Exodus. They start in our text here with having a covenant made between them and God. And they end in the valleys of Amos, running around to try and find God's word, but not being able to find it. This is, in a sense, what we would call an epic tragedy. This was a tragedy because God's word, of course, for God's people, has always been at the center of our life. I'll say that again. God's word for God's people has always been at the center of our life, whether it's our personal life or our communal life. In the Old Testament, the people of Israel were born out of God speaking. In fact, we can go back beyond that, can't we? We can go back to the first book of Moses, to Genesis. And of course, his books begin with God's word in creation. We can say that everything was born out of God's word. God spoke and the heavens became. God spoke and the universe was born. God spoke and there was light. His word later in that book, after his utterance has created the universe, pronounces blessing for, if you like, the probationary person of Adam as he stands created in a paradise. God speaks in terms of blessing on his obedience and a warning of his disobedience. Later in the same book, the same voice pronounces judgment and hope after Adam's sin in Genesis and chapter 3. The same voice announces favor on Noah amidst a crescendo of evil and judgment upon his generation in chapter 6 through 9. The same voice speaks and calls Abram to follow him and out and to cut a covenant with him and his family in order in due time to bring forth the anointed Saviour, the Lord Jesus. Genesis 12 to 15. Same voice all the way through the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, to the book of Jude and Revelation at the end. Reveal God's nature. In the book we've looked at, we're looking at now, in the book of Exodus, God speaks, reveals himself, and tells Moses of his plan to deliver his people in the first chapters of Exodus. He remembers his covenant with Abraham, and he calls his people to freedom, the freedom of service. He pronounces judgment on Pharaoh. And here in the chapters we're looking at from Exodus 20 and following, he's revealed more of his character, more of his purposes, more of his will through speaking again. The very people of Israel have heard the voice of God directly. See, what's the point here? Well, the point here is that from the beginning, a pattern is set up. God's word is incapable of being distinguished, much less divorced from God himself. His people, even us today, are never to conceive of God speaking as the mere reflections of humanity. God's word for God's people, both in command and covenant, is not only to have the last word, but he's also got to have the first word. And as someone once wrote, and every word in between. But what we see, what befell Israel in Amos' time is a long way from the text that we have in front of us today. But in our hearts, as we all know, the distance between obedience and rebellion can be infinitesimal. It can only take a look, a thought, change of channel, click on the internet, an action or a reaction, to go from a place where we are following hard after God to turning in on ourselves. That's the reality of the Christian life. And we have to remember today, and we're going to remember as we look at part of the sections that I outlined last time in terms of the book of the covenant, the blood of the covenant, and the blessing of the covenant. We're going to look to see how we can tune out the background noise of our sinful nature. You've noticed that, haven't you? You know, we're all used to background noise, aren't we? Fiona and Hayley in my house, they're used to background noise because I always have the radio on, as I said before. And every day they'll say, why do you have to have the radio on? You're not even in the same room. You're doing something completely different. Why is the radio on? I just said, because I just like the background noise. Well, as humans, there's a background noise, isn't there, to life. Not just the clamour from outside, but there is the, if you like, the narcissistic drone of our sinful nature. And that's sometimes fanned by the world and the enemy of our souls into a chorus. I often think it this way, you know, what is that melody that often plays in the background of our lives? Well, it was put into words by none other than the great Frank Sinatra. I did it my way. I did it my way. It was interesting, wasn't it, a couple of weeks ago when Donald Trump left office in the US and he flew back to his holiday home in Florida. That was the mood music to his exit. If you watched it when you got on the plane, they started playing, I did it my way. But they sang it better than that, probably. But it wasn't just the mood music to Donald Trump. It's actually the mood music to humanity apart from Christ. That's the tune that's going on all the time in our heads, all the time in our actions, all the time in our reactions. Because we think that we, as created beings, or as evolved beings sometimes from some quarters, we think that we've got nobody to be accountable to but ourselves. But you see, the Bible tells us different. The Bible tells us, and as we've seen through Exodus, that it's God who speaks, that God who creates, it's God who calls, that there is a God who created heaven and earth. And we are accountable to him. As we'll see through this particular section, we're only going to look at a couple of verses today. But I want us to see how we can silence that chorus and train our eyes, incline even our hearts to God's word once again, and respond consistently. Even as Israel does here in our text. Just have a look at the text in front of you. Exodus 24. We're only going to look at verses 3, the first part of verse 4 and verse 7. Just want to read them again. It says this: Moses came and told all the people all the words of the Lord and all the rules. And all the people answered with one voice and said, all the words that the Lord has spoken we will do. And Moses wrote down all the words of the Lord. Verse 7, then he took the book of the covenant and read it in the hearing of the people. And they said, all that the Lord has spoken, we will do, and we will be obedient. I just want to draw four conclusions, four inferences from those verses. One, the priority of the revealed word for God's people. You know, we are not God's people without God's word calling us into being and preserving us. Secondly, the parity of the rehearsed word. I'll come back to that in a minute. Thirdly, the preservation of the recorded word. And fourthly, the power of the received word. And that's where I want to end today. Firstly, then, the priority of God's word. We've seen this again and again, and I don't wish to overuse it this morning. But we see here the first thing that Moses does from coming down the mountain. If you look there, it says Moses came, and as we said last week in terms of remembering the grand old Duke of York going up and down, we said that Moses comes down and the first thing he does is to pass on what God has told him. And again, looking back, there's been a time when God has spoken to the nation as a whole. They heard God speak and begged him to stop. Moses has gone up the mountain and God has spoken to him and given him the book of the covenant, that section of text we've gone through and sucked the principles out of it for us. Well, Moses has come down and the first thing he does is to tell the people all the words of the Lord. And you'll see this time and time again in scripture, in principle and in practice, that as I said before, God's people are constituted, are brought together, and they are directed by God's word. What does that mean here? It means that what God was going to do in terms of showing them faithfulness, in showing them blessing, in calling them to be a people, in taking them into a promised land, he told them beforehand, he spoke into their lives. God took the initiative again. He's done it all the way through Exodus. He's done it all the way through Genesis. He will do it all the way through the Bible until, you know, Revelation and into eternity in the future. God will speak. And as we saw in Psalm 117, once God speaks and reveals himself, it is incumbent upon us to respond. And let's not fool ourselves. It is impossible not to respond to the revealed word. Now you might sit on your chair saying, well, actually, Gary, I don't know if I agree with you there. You know, I mean, I can hear, I can read the Bible, but I can choose not to do it. I can choose not to respond. Well, my answer is that you have responded. You have responded. You've responded in terms of rejecting God's word. Every time we do that, as we see later, there is a consequence. You know, see, the power, we'll come back to in a few minutes, the power of the received word is not just the power to transform us positively. If we receive the word, even as the people of Israel did here, and it's repeated, isn't it? All the words of the Lord we will do. You know, good for them. They stood together as one community and said, you know, whatever you want, Lord, we'll do it. What a great place to be. But there's also another power to the word. As the Puritan said, there's the same word, the same sun that melts the wax, hardens the clay. Speaking of our heart. And so you see, in terms of God's word, God does speak. Thank God that he is a speaking God. Thank God that God does take the initiative, for without that initiative, without that priority, without that primacy, we would be lost. We would be like the people pictured in Amos. If God says, I'm not going to speak anymore, then it's bad news for humanity, because we cannot find our way to him on our own. We do not have the ability, and most of the time, apart from Christ, we do not want to either. We are spiritually unable and we are spiritually unwilling. Our state before repentance and faith is hostility to the God of the Bible. We don't want to know, as John Collins in his gospel, men love darkness rather than light because our deeds are evil. That's a strange thing to say, isn't it? We are drowned in a culture that tells us that we're good people, aren't we? You know, my friend, as I said, I've got a friend, good old Malcolm, lovely guy, and every conversation I have, you know, Gary, we're good people. We're good people. I was standing in his shop some while ago, and he said to me, how you doing, mate? And I looked at him and said, oh, better than I deserve. And he sort of face clouded a minute. He said, what do you mean better than you deserve? You're good people. And I said, well, it depends on what perspective you take from God's perspective. You know, we are not good people. We were born rebels. And only by his grace can our character and nature be transformed. That doesn't mean to say, of course, we're all as bad as we could have been. You know, there's a restraining power in the heart of every human being. What we call common grace. You know, why do we have laws? Why are there good moral people? You know, sometimes wonderfully moral, philanthropic people outside of Christ. That's because of the common grace of God, you know, and the restraining power of the Holy Spirit across humanity. It's not because of anything in us. You know as well as I do, and I know it only too well looking in the mirror, that given the right circumstance and the right motivation, I could do the worst things imaginable. Well, you know, I hope that doesn't shock you, because if you know yourself, it shouldn't. Given the right set of circumstances, the right motivation, We can do terrible things. I was reading a book a little while ago, and it mentioned some of the women that had worked for the Nazis in Germany, who had were wardens in the concentration camps. And this book interestingly said these women were not terrible people. And we think, what? You know, how can you do what you did and not be a terrible person? But the point was this: he said they were normal people who did terrible things. Normal people who would leave a concentration camp and go and pick up their kids from school. And go and, you know, make tea for their husbands and vice versa. We know, don't we, if we're honest, that given the right circumstance, the right coming together of events and the right motivation, we can do terrible things. That is who we are as fallen human beings. But thanks be to God, because God is a speaking God, because he takes the initiative, because his word comes to us time and time again out of his grace, he wants so much more from us than this. Moses comes and he speaks and he told the people, notice all the words and all the rules, not just, didn't just go over the Ten Commandments. He went over what he'd been told too. It wasn't just what they had heard from God directly, but what he was rehearsing to them. And that's important. Because we see in these verses the parity of the rehearsed word. And this is important for us because we are people of the book, aren't we? You know, we believe the Bible, we want to be soaked in the Bible. Right? Well, we have to understand that there is a parity between the revealed word and the rehearsed word. You know, God speaks to the people, God speaks to Moses, but the people respond to what Moses tells them as the very words of God. You don't have to say, well, you can say this, Moses, but I want to hear God speak himself. No, they understand that what God tells Moses is still on a par with his revealed and spoken word. It is his word. Now, that's important for us because we are on the top of Sinai. We're not on the Mount of Transfiguration. We're not standing on Calvary. We're not sitting in Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost. All we have is the rehearsed word. We have the Bible. But we must understand that God's written word is on a par with a direct revelation of God. In fact, you know, now in our era, if you like, as part of the covenant we have with Christ, you know, God's written word is raised as an infallible standard. And anything else that we have, whether it be a gift of the Spirit or a word of encouragement from someone else, we have to measure it against this rule. Friends, we are people of the book, and here the people of Israel understand that there is parity. There is parity in terms of what God says directly with what Moses rehearses to them. There is parity in terms of what Moses writes down. Yeah, because he tells them and they respond, and then he goes and writes it down. Yeah, we've seen that already in chapter 17, I think, where Moses writes it down. You know, it's interesting, isn't it, that in terms of the preservation and the permanence of the word, God has given us the ability to write it down. He wanted it written down so it was preserved for us. You know, one of the wonderful things that science has done, apart from invent the pickled onion, the height of scientific you know, achievement, in my view, has given us ways of testing whether we have a consistent and reliable Bible. A few years ago, again, in a report I was reading, there was a report of how they had used new X-ray technology to X-ray scrolls that were, you know, 1,500, 2,000 years old, and were able, even in a scroll that couldn't be rolled out, They could take an X-ray photograph, which would actually allow them to, and computers would be able to present the whole text. And you know what they found? You know what they found in terms of, you know, the text of Exodus and the text of Isaiah and other Old Testament texts? You know, things written down well before, you know, the coming of Christ. They found consistency. They found that the Bible that you have in front of you, translated as it is into English, into text you can understand in modern parlance, is consistent and reliable. It's the same word. The same word that was spoken by Amos. The same word that the kings of Israel would read and write for themselves as they became a king of Judah. That same scripture has been passed down and preserved for us. It's interesting, is it? Even Moses here, you know, he writes the first five books of the Bible, and you can see his activity. He's writing down, he's recording, because the word needs to be preserved from one generation to the next. And God, in his grace, has given you a library of his revelation. don't know what the most expensive book you've got is, or the most precious book you've got is, but let me tell you, there's no more precious book than the library we have given by God himself for his glory and for our good. And as human beings, you know, we need to take seriously the access we have to the book, the access we have to the word. Why? Well, because Jesus said that if you are given much, then much will be expected. Remember when he walked around Galilee and Judea and he said, "Woe to you, Bethsaida. Woe to you, Capernaum. Woe to you, Chorazin." These were places. He says, you know, on judgment day, it'll be worse for you than it was for Sodom and Gomorrah. Why? Because they had been given much more light. Jesus himself had walked their streets and spoken and taught. And he said, more will be expected of you. Well, friends, we live in a culture and an age with all its faults and failures where we have access. We have the privilege of open access to the word. The preserved word. Now, listen, there are some people who are going to misunderstand that preserved word. There's a trend in some Christians to exalt a certain version created in 1611. And I don't want to talk about that today. But it's necessary to know that that's not what I'm talking about. You know, the word you have, the translations you have, the critical text that we have that has been put together by mostly Bible-believing scholars is a wonderful testimony to the reality and the reliability of Scripture. Here, God's word is recorded and preserved. In other words, you know, and that carries with it a responsibility. It carried with it a responsibility for the people of Israel. You know, they had the Book of the Covenant. Sad to say, in the future, they came to times when they had forgotten the Book of the Covenant. You know, I think it was King Josiah, or was it Hezekiah? I can't remember which one it was now. After a time of rebellion and idolatry, goes and he finds the Book of the Covenant is found in the temple. And the priests read it and they think, oh no, we've gone wrong. And they take it to the king and he tears his clothes and he says, oh wow, we are in big trouble. Because the word had been preserved. Friends, the word has been preserved for you, and we, as God's people today, are responsible to it. Again, because we cannot separate God from his word. It betokens his character and nature. It is who he is given to us in his word. Finally, I want us to look at the power of the received word. We've looked at the priority of the revealed word, the parity of the rehearsed word, the preservation of the recorded word, and the power of the received word. Notice what the people do when they hear. When they hear it spoken and they hear it read, they are enabled to respond. And they respond. It's not that they are made, it's not coercion. You know, their arms aren't stuck up their backs. But God in his grace opens their heart to see the beauty that is in God himself and his word. You know, I remember many years ago speaking, and I'm sure we've all had this, you know, this idea to a young person. Said, oh, you know, church is just a bit boring. You know, isn't God a bit boring? And I said, not if we see him as he is. Not if we receive his word as it is. Not if we understand the beauty and the glory and the excellency and the perfection of the God who speaks to us. What a wonder it is for God to speak. And the power of the received word here, you know, energizes and enthuses and empowers God's people. As I say, you know, I understand that power is two-edged. Power is two-edged. You know, it is the word of life to those who God is saving, and it is the word of death to those who are perishing. I understand, but we need to understand that there is a power to elevate, and there is a power to judge. There is a power to save, and there is a power to damn in the word of God. And friends, my hope and prayer for us all is that we are on the side of the power of the received word that leads to life. I trust that's so. The people hear the word of God and they respond to it. You know, that's not the end of the story, because things have got to happen now. Things have got to happen to put this covenant in place. Blood has to be shed. Because one of the things that God's word tells us is that we are naturally estranged from God, and something needs to happen in order that we can approach. So we'll see next week the blood of the covenant, which will remind us of the seriousness of sin and the grace of God. And then we'll see in the third week, be here for that one, because that's when we get to see what we have in the blessing of the covenant, where, you know, it's betokened in these verses. The leaders go up into the presence of God, and notice what it says there. It's a little verse. He didn't lay a hand on them. Though they deserved to die because of their sinfulness, it had been covered by blood. And God says, come and sit and dwell and eat and drink with me. That's an amazing thing for you and I, folks. Let's enjoy that as we get to it. In Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to hear a song sung to us which talks about an undivided heart. And the crux of what we've been saying today will be measured by our response to God's word. Will our heart remain divided? Will we listen to the "I did it my way" background music? Or will we be enabled by the proclamation of God's word to declare and confess our love and worship of God? Thank you.
Give me an undivided heart, that I might fear your name. Teach me to walk in righteous paths and follow in your ways. For you are gracious and forgiving. Hear, O Lord, and answer me. Give me an undivided mind, that I might love your word. Help me to hunger for your voice and know your spirit, soul. For you are good, your truth unchanging. Life is found in serving you. Whatever the pain, whatever the cost. bloody cross. I live for him who died for me.
God has spoken through his word that has been proclaimed to us. What is the state of our heart? What is the category of response that we make? Is it undivided? Are we single-minded? Is our desire toward God, his will and ways and his work in our lives? We're not promised great success or great wealth or great popularity. We're not promised that everything will go easy or even well in the compartments of this life. But we are promised the presence and the power of God. Promised an eternal destiny beyond anything this world can give. Our hope is not merely for this life only and its ups and downs, though God is a wonderful help. Jesus is brilliant, but he offers us a hope and a future, an eternity with him, an eternity with a God who will still speak first, who will still reach out to us. What is the state of our heart? Let's examine them together as we come around the Lord's table.
As we've been hearing the word this morning and the theme of God's word, and maybe some of us this morning just feel like we've not been as close to the Lord, and we've not held on as much, and we've struggled. And the point is that as we come to communion, it is Christ's blood that covers every sin. Mm. Jesus has paid the price for every sin. And that is the thing, that God is not there harsh saying, where have you been? Why have you not been reading my word? Why have you not been drawing near to me? He's calling us to draw near because he loves us. He's calling us to have an undivided heart, because he knows that the best thing he can give to us is himself. So as we take communion, as we think on what we've heard this morning, we can rejoice in knowing that we have a Father in heaven who is reaching out and saying, come to me, because my son's already paid the price.
For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
One of my God would bring you down to earth. What king would take a low and lonely birth? Yet to this dark and broken place you came, to sleep beneath the stars that you had made. What love, my God, would send the way of life to walk the road rejected and despised, that you might know the weakness I possess and be my rock of strength and righteousness. As heaven opens.
in his love like a mighty flood. What love, my God, could hold you to the tree, to bear that overwhelming debt for me? The Son of Heaven leaves the Father's side, the Healer bleeds, the life was made to die. Love, my God, so gracious and extreme, was strong enough to come and fight for me, to go through hell and down into the grave, and raise me up to see you face to face. You raised me up to see you face to face. Oh, your love, my God, like a flood, as heaven opened up, pouring out on us. Oh, praise the King who came to the world in his love like a mighty flood, in his love like a mighty flood.
Let's pray together. Father, we thank you, Lord, that we can come to you, Lord, as a demonstration of your people, called together in a congregation. Lord, we can come and we can pray. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you call upon us to pray, you call upon us to cast our cares upon you. Yes. Lord, and this is evidence of your care for us, that you are concerned intimately, Lord, with our lives. Lord, we're amazed by that. But Lord, we are less than a speck of dust when we compare with who you are. But Lord, you have set your love upon us. Lord, you've revealed your steadfast love and faithfulness to us, Lord, most perfectly in the gift of your Son Jesus, who lived a perfect life for us, who died in our place for our sin and was raised on the third day. Lord, in him, Lord, you have clothed us with righteousness. Lord, we have been given a righteousness that was not our own. And Lord, we can walk in a restored relationship with you as our Father. Lord, we can be taken out of darkness, out of death, out of alienation, out of the pit of sin. And we can walk before you on a broad road. Lord, a broad place of salvation. And Lord, we can look towards you. And we look toward meeting you face to face. Father, we pray, Lord, as we enter a new week, Lord, we pray for our nation, pray for our government, pray for those who are serving us, pray particularly again, Lord, as this pandemic continues to roll out, Lord, that you would, in your mercy, remember us, Lord, that you would fulfill your purposes through this pandemic, and Lord, that you would bring us out the other side. Lord, as your people, Lord, we want to come out refined. Lord, in terms of the nations, Lord, we can see that they will come out humbled and yet still contesting your rule. So Lord, we pray, Lord, that you would help us. Help us in your church, Lord, across the nations to be faithful to the gospel. Lord, we pray for our brothers and sisters in places where they are persecuted and are encountering difficulty, Lord, for their faith. We pray that the Spirit of God and of glory would rest upon them in their suffering. We pray that for us, for our fellowship and for one another, that you would help us, strengthen us and comfort us. Help us to love one another with your love. Help us to bear with one another in difficulty. Help us to rejoice with those who rejoice. And help us to weep with those who weep. We ask all this in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. I'm going to end our time together just in benediction. We pray that the God who speaks, and in speaking, saves and sustains. May he continue to sanctify you in your response to him. May he enlarge our capacity and appetite for he who is the very goal of the gospel. May we long for him alone in this week, and in longing for him, be satisfied. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.